This next guest we have is no stranger to our industry. I'm pleased to have on the stage with me Chair and CEO of Intercontinental Exchange, Jeff Sprecher. Jeff, my staff wrote me a very long introduction for you. I'm going to skip it if you don't mind. He's important. He's incredibly innovative in our field, and we're going to jump right into the questions. So Jeff, in my introduction, I talked a bit about last time we were here at the Sheraton in 1999. ICE hadn't even begun as an exchange, and when you think about the evolution of ICE from a markets company to I don't know what you would call it today. I mean, we call this the exchange leaders conversation, but how do you think about ICE as a company now? What would you just, if you were in a cocktail conversation with somebody, how would you describe ICE to somebody who's not familiar with our industry?
First of all, it's great to be here. And it's nice that most of the other exchange leaders had scheduling conflicts. So that I don't have to spar with anybody. Honestly, in my mind, we are a database management company. Just happens to be in financial services. But exchanges are just networks that attach to a database. Honestly, they're very distributed databases. There's nobody that trades in the futures markets or in the stock markets that doesn't know what their position is. Their brokers know what their position is. The clearing firms know what their position is. The regulators know what their position is. So we run conventionally distributed databases on a network. And I have just kind of led the company into additional markets from the traditional commodities markets where we started that share that same characteristic.
And one of those areas is mortgages, and you've been involved in several acquisitions, Black Knight being the most recent. Tell us about the status of those acquisitions, but also what's the vision? Certainly the markets side is a bit of a mature business, still doing very well, but also the mortgage business, especially in the United States, very inefficient. Tell us a bit about your strategy here.
Sure. Well, even though I've been in this industry a long time, I'm probably the oldest guy in the room here. When I didn't come from this business, and so when I got into the industry, the contract that everybody was interested in trading was CME Euro dollars. And I asked people, like, what is a Euro dollar? Like, I was thinking it's a Euro versus a dollar, right? It was a foreign exchange pair, and which it's not. And it was basically LIBOR interest rates. And then I said, well, why would someone want to trade a euro dollar? And why does somebody want LIBOR? And the answer was, well, they're hedging mortgages and corporate debt and other interest rate oriented projects. And so, just since my whole career here, I've been thinking, well, why wouldn't we segment those markets? And so a few years ago, we led ICE into the bond markets. We were late into those markets in terms of trading. We had a number of well-established venues that were already doing bond trading. And so we said, well, can we go into settlement and data, parts of the business that aren't trading but are familiar to us? And the bond market is just the cash market for corporate borrowing. And so then we started to think about how would we get into the cash market for consumer borrowing, which is mortgages. So while it looks like, Jeff has taken this company in all these different directions, the reality is it harkens back to when we first started the company, and I'm trying to figure out what is a euro dollar and why would anybody want to trade it. Now we have SOFR and SONIA, so you have something equally as non-intuitive to a layperson. But to answer your question, many of you, this is a pretty elite group in here, so many people I assume have gotten a mortgage in their life, and it is so complicated. And the reality is, for people that you know, in the United States at least, that have 20% down, that want to buy a conforming mortgage, that that established a fair market price of their house through a bid, that may have a payment history. That takes about 2 months for that person to get a mortgage. And amazingly, when you look at them, you know, you can today you fill out a mortgage application online, but what you may not realize is that behind the scenes then the lender may hit the print button and they print it out onto paper, and then somebody else scans it, and then they, you know, it goes from PDF to paper to PDF to paper, and there's no common data standards. And when in most states in the United States, when you go to consummate your mortgage, you have to go have a wet signature on a piece of paper, which then makes its way into a cardboard box, which has a barcode on it, which then ends up in a mini storage warehouse. And I don't know, that just, for somebody that runs databases and networks, it just feels and is antiquated. And so we said, you know, if we can discover the cash market, make it easy to have a cash market and discover the prices, then we're gonna do, you know, a lot of good for the consumer, and we'll be able to figure out on the back of that what changes to the capital markets follow on.
And do you see, by bringing these two businesses together, are there synergies that you've seen where the markets people are helping to solve problems on the mortgage side and vice versa? I mean, this is a straight through processing, you know, question that you're talking about. Is, are you seeing some benefits to that mixture?
Yeah, so imagine, you know, what's also interesting is that the money that goes into a home mortgage comes from, largely comes from wholesale markets that then create derivatives that up until recently were being bought by the US government. The way that works is that this wholesaler will go to a lender and say, give me your next 100 mortgages and I'll give you, you know, 60 or 90 days to fulfill that, and here's my interest rate that I'll charge you. And so there's a lag because of the time it takes to write and manufacture a mortgage. There's a lag between when the interest rates are set by the wholesale market and when the consumer locks their rate, if you will, and that gets hedged. And so there's a tremendous amount of friction in the capital market. All that gets priced into the price of a mortgage. And I'll tell you, you know, one of the most amazing things to me that happened during COVID was, you know, we own the New York Stock Exchange. And the New York Stock Exchange was started in front of the nation's first capital. The nation's first capital was actually in New York. George Washington was sworn in New York. The Bill of Rights was drafted in New York, you know, not Washington, not Philadelphia. And in front of the Capitol, a group of 24 brokers sat under a tree and they started trading the nation's first stocks. And the first company that listed on the New York Stock Exchange was the Bank of New York, which is still listed on the New York Stock Exchange. And the first loan of the Bank of New York was to the US government to pay for the first Congress. So if you think about the formation of the New York Stock Exchange, it formed with our country. And it grew, it's grown tremendously over 230 years, or plus or minus. And I think it formed in 1792. It actually became called the Stock Exchange. And if you think about that, you think about the invention of electricity, right, or steam cars, then electricity, then the telegraph, right? I mean, at the time it was formed, you had Paul Revere riding with lantern, you know, on a horse. And so you think of the communications growth, where today you've got high frequency traders bouncing off of the ionosphere in order to get an edge. And if you think about how much stock trading had globalized and grown up to year, you know, 2020, let's say pre-COVID, that number doubled in 1 year during COVID. Like, you have the entire, you know, investment of technology, of modern man, and in 1 year it doubled. Why? Because Robinhood gave away free trading. Like, it's so amazing to me that when you think about, if you can take the costs out of the things we do here, the volumes go to the roof. And so what I've been trying to say to lenders, regulators, people in the mortgage space is, you're making this so expensive and so complicated for a, particularly for a segment of society that you're not buying a consumable, you're buying something that actually has a foundation that can't be moved, that's part of Pavlov's hierarchy of needs, you know, security and safety, that people will be the last thing people will give up when they're in financial trouble. And yet we make it so complicated. If we can take those costs out, you'll see home ownership go up, volumes will go up. It just, if it can happen to a 230-year-old business, it can certainly happen there. And that's a long-winded way of saying why I'm passionate about solving that problem.
Well, let's turn to the market side of the business. There are some incredible headwinds right now with inflation, rising interest rates, volatility in the energy markets in particular. How are the market side of your business doing with those economic headwinds, as I mentioned?
Well, we had the best first quarter in our history, we had the best second quarter in our history, and we've had the best third quarter in our history. So,
pretty good.
We're in the, these are futures, right? So it's the market trying to deal with expectations of the future, and all the things you talked about are complicated and cause people to want to manage risk. There are a lot of headwinds. You know, the markets like stability, stability of regulation, stability of supply chain, and there's been a lot of complications in energy and food, and in interest rates, I guess you could say too. Although the central banks tend to signal what they're doing, but the supply chains in energy and food have been impacted by war and intervention of governments around that war, and so it makes it hard for our industry to use those markets, harder, but nonetheless the need to use them is high.
I want to talk about last week's elections, and we're a highly regulated industry. But it's ultimately overseen by Congress and the elections, and they set policy direction for the country. I'm curious what your overall assessment of the midterms are and what that means for our industry in particular.
Well, in the U.S., at least, you know, as we sit here today, we don't know the final outcome of our Congress specifically, but it's pretty fair to say that it's a divided country, you know, 50-50. Divided country, which probably means, however it shakes out, we're likely to have more of a status quo than some kind of revolution. I think we'll have more evolution. Status quo is usually pretty good for business in the sense that it's predictable. Maybe not desirable, but predictable. And so... You know, I think it, particularly the U.S. Congress is the throttle on spending, and if it's a complicated Congress, you're probably not going to get a lot of spending through, which may, you know, in connection with what the U.S. central bank's doing, will help throttle inflation, I would expect.
And do you see, a lot of these crypto bills that are out there are bipartisan bills? Now there is a bit of a crisis, as Rahm Emanuel said, make sure to take advantage of crisis, right?
Yeah.
Do you think that there will be crypto legislation next year given divided government?
I do, just because, government tends to be reactionary, yeah. And I'm not sure that there's any partisan nature of this. And to the extent that people, accepted money in government, from the crypto industry, they may be quick to show that they're not influenced by that, so that they're not tarnished with that moniker. But honestly, well, there's no more volume of laws and regulation in the world than handling someone else's money. Okay, I mean, literally, a guy named Moses came down a mountain, and it was in a stone, right? That you shouldn't steal. And ever since then, and at least in my religion, ever since then, man has added to that tablet of, more rules and laws and what have you about handling other people's money. I mean, we all exist in an industry that has to respond to those. And we're audited all the time by the SEC, the CFTC, the Bank of England, the Singapore regulator, you name it. And they always find something wrong, And we're like trying to do as best as we can, with a lot of resources and what have you. But the rules are so voluminous and fussy that it's just hard for me to imagine that we need more rules. I have never understood why the regulators haven't taken a firmer view of the crypto industry. We set up a crypto company that we took public, but it was set up to be a regulated entity just because it's what we knew and figured that it needed to be. I've always found it odd that the regulators haven't used existing rules a little more aggressively, because they certainly aren't shy with us.
Yeah.
or any of you in this room. The crypto industry has some of the best lawyers. Maybe some of you are those lawyers in here, but some of the best lawyers in the world. I mean, has somehow created this image that it's something different, that issuing a security on a token as opposed to filing an S-1 is somehow different, and issuing a commodity, which is really a currency pair, on our commodity exchange, on everything, Walt, that you've built this industry around, we sell things in dollars and euros and pounds, largely. We don't have any kind of, faux dollar, faux euro, or faux pound. And those, in my mind, were created not because these are commodities, because there is a pretty, if you were trying to avoid being regulated, a really good area to delve in is the cash foreign exchange markets. And in order to have, which are all traded in pair, it's one currency versus another. So rather than buy Bitcoin in dollars, let's create, a tokenized faux dollar that will call it something different, and then we can have a currency pair that will make it harder to regulate. But I've always thought that, particularly after Dodd-Frank and Emir, that regulators had a lot more discretion in the FX markets, particularly for retail. And I have never understood exactly why those haven't been deployed by regulators.
I want to ask on the FTX situation in particular. Last year when we were at Expo, you went off stage after your exchange leaders, you expressed concerns about the FTX model from a competitive standpoint. I think there were concerns that real-time margining, real-time liquidation, disintermediation could be a trend that could disrupt mm-hmm. things. So in hindsight of what we know from last week, Tribu in the earlier panel talked about that this reiterates the importance of compartmentalizing risk in the different functions, having intermediaries as separate entities and not collapsing it into one type of organization. But what's your sense? I mean, what are the lessons learned? There must be some of those things still are vital. I think Jerome asked the question this morning. The technology is still interesting, minus the fraud aspect of what we're talking about from last week. So how do you assess last week's? What's the lessons learned?
Well, I don't know that we know all the lessons yet, but you know, generally speaking, in the kind of exchanges that are represented by the FIA and those that are securities exchanges under the SEC, you can't have an exchange and a market maker and the clearing settlement organization under one roof. I mean, they can be commonly owned in certain circumstances, but they're differently governed, and a lot of different reporting and audit. And so there is a segregation of duties there that I think were commingled. It looks like they were commingled at FTX. But also, you know, it appears that the FTX token, the FTT, to me, they issued a security and then used it as an IOU, in other words, as a debt instrument against their captive market maker to borrow customer funds, maybe without their knowledge, maybe without their permission. I don't know the terms of service, but to be fair to FTX, but here they were issuing equities and debt with a common market maker in exchange, where the settlement was inside the you know, commingled in that organization. So. So, you know, a lot of people in our industry have particularly, you know, galvanized around the FIA to talk about why we segregate those things. It's not fun. It's not convenient. We clearly could put everything, you know, on one computer, and we could eliminate a lot of jobs and just have some kind of token decide what should happen, you know, a smart contract, if you will. And but I really think, we advocate a lot when we're talking to regulators and legislators of what it takes to manage through a default with human intervention. You know, we were very, you know, when Dodd-Frank was passed and EMIR came out of the EU, and they got much more specific than Dodd-Frank and the way clearinghouses should manage defaults. And I remember distinctively during that period saying, don't try to define how a clearinghouse should manage a default, because no two are alike. You know, it's like every contract you've ever written in your life, you try to think of every eventuality, but there's always the thing that you never thought about, that now you're both looking at the contract saying, well, how is this gonna work? And that's why we have courts. And so the more you can give a lot of smart humans discretion in a liquidation, in a bankruptcy, the better. And, you know, it's why FTX has actually run to a bankruptcy court that has a judge, and it's why the court has installed an administrator that is a human. You know, we didn't have some forced liquidation. There will be judgment used on allocation of assets and how to convert them to proper capital, where they should go, who has title, and I, you know, it's not because technology couldn't do all that. I really think this is a better outcome. I, you know, having said that, there's a whole group of DeFi advocates that say, you know, just the opposite of what I'm saying that the FTX collapse proves that we should go more automated and less oversight and have computers decide it all. But I think that is a terrible mistake from my experience.
Well, Jeff, unfortunately, we're over time. We're gonna have to cut it short here. I just wanna thank Jeff and the entire ICE organization. They're always big supporters of Expo. Jeff is normally downstairs serving hot dogs on the Expo
floor. By the way, he's saying this because he knows FTX is not gonna be your big sponsor next year.
That's right. That's right.
Pretty transparent.
So get your checkbook out. So, but we do, in all sincerity, we appreciate you being here as always, and thank you.
Thank you, Chairman.
Yeah.
Thank you.